Thank you for joining AutoNetwork Reports. I'm your host, Roosevelt, and we will take you inside the auto industry like never before. And today we have a special guest on the show. Our topic today is the Black press and car company advertising. And there's no better person from the Black press side to discuss that than the president and CEO of NNPA, National Newspaper Publishers Association, and Dr. Ben Chavis. Dr. Chavis, thanks for taking the time to join us on Auto Network Reports.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to be with you. And thank you for all the great work that you do informing our community and other communities of color about the opportunities, the deals, and which way the trends of the auto industry in America. Thank you.
I'm going to have to pay you $5 for saying that instead of the traditional $1 for that plug. But anyway, I appreciate it. Thanks very much. What I'd like to do before I get into my first questions, I want to preface it with some background. And I got this information off your website. And sure. your organization represents over 230 African-American newspapers across the country. You have 22 million readers per week, about 12 to 16 million page views daily on your website. 12 million Facebook followers, 15 million Twitter followers, 10 million Instagram followers. And I guess my question is, why aren't car companies just banging down your doors to advertise with you nationally when they all say we want to reach the African-American market?
That's a very good question. And it's a question not only for today's program, but this is a question that the advertising industry in America is wrestling with right now. The issue is that does media do total market targeting, or does it does selective and ethnic market or a specific zone or zone casting or targeting different communities based on their needs? And what has happened is that the big car companies, they have what I would call mainstream ad agencies. And these agencies claim that they can reach African-Americans better than the Black press, which is obviously not true, but that's what they claim. And so a lot of times, big automakers like General Motors or Ford or Stellantis or Toyota or Hyundai, et cetera, they would make a decision where they have millions of dollars, hundreds of millions of dollars, advertising dollars, but it never filters down to agencies like the National Newspaper Publishers Association that represents the Black press. We get triaged on the one hand, and then on the other hand, we don't get contemplated, even though what the stats you cited, Roosevelt, are accurate. We have a major sphere of influence, impact. And I would also say that we have something that other media doesn't have. We are the trusted voice. The Black press in America today is 195 years old, actually. First started in 1827 when Freedom Journal was first published in New York City. So for 195 years, the Black press has not only printed the news, but we've also been an advocate for freedom, justice, equality, and now I would also say equity. Equity is another term that's kind of thrown around now in the auto world as well as the advertising world. But that's the reason, is because we have not yet have the kind of relationship with the big automobile companies where they would see the value in doing direct advertising with the NNPA versus indirect, or sometimes no direct at all, by using the other ad agencies that purport in terms of total market versus selected market.
You know, your network of newspapers, they're old. They've been around, some of them for 100 years. Yes. I think most of them are probably over 50 years. And for businesses
the majority are over 50. And the majority are also, which may surprise you, the publishers are Black women. Because most of them have inherited the papers from their husbands who may have passed on. And so a lot of our papers are also intergenerational, have been in families for almost 100 years. And certainly the average age of our paper is around 60-65 years.
So for businesses to stay in business that long, they must be doing something right in the community. And it's not like they're out distributing nationally, talking on the print side. They are distributing in and around their communities where they live. So they be doing something right to be able to stay in the business that long. Then they must be reaching the individuals that they want to reach. So what is the I still want to know, what is it, the disconnect that the car companies just don't see?
Well, I think that's a very good, we should have some of the representatives of the car companies on here so they can help answer that question. Obviously, we interface with them. I'm in Detroit a lot at all the major conferences and when they had the various auto shows in the big cities. But it boils down to, you know, most of these companies have something called a CMO, a chief marketing officer. And very few of the automobile companies have a person of color as their CMO. So when you're not in charge of marketing, when you're not in charge of delivering return on the investment to the client, to the automaker, and if you're not from one of these communities of color, then you are apt to skew or really underestimate or undervalue having someone on your staff or having somebody as the chief marketer representing these communities of color. Because right now, if you look at who buys automobiles in America today, brand new automobiles as well as used automobiles, our communities over-index our population. African Americans are around 15% of the American population, but we buy 20 to 30% of all the automobiles in America.
Question from the panelists. I don't want to take up all the time.
Dr. Chavis, you've been in the fight for equality longer than either one of us want to admit, because like I said, I've been tracking you for several years.
Yes, sir.
When we talk about these conversations you have to have with the manufacturers and their agencies, what is the feeling you get based on your feedback? Are they listening to you and taking you seriously? Or is it just more lip service from your perspective?
That's another very good question. I think that they listen, but they don't hear. This is what I'm saying. We have an opportunity to have dialogue with them in person. We do a lot of Zoom calls. We even have in-person meetings in Detroit or wherever the city they're based in. But after those meetings, they go back, they revert back as if the conversation never was held. Because what they depend on for advice and counsel is not from us. They depend on advice and counsel for advertising from the ad agencies that they have returned. And keep in mind, I've had some dialogue with some of these ad agencies. Well, these ad agencies tell the big automobiles, look, you don't need to deal with these minority-owned ad agencies. Deal with us, that is the big companies. We know how to reach their communities better than they do. And unfortunately, big automakers seem to align with that kind of notion rather than even on an experimental basis trying to use minority-owned advertising agents or minority-owned distributors of the advertising content.
I know for a fact there are companies like Boulevard and 1030 done some work for the manufacturers. When
and
you have these conversations with
those
OEMs,
are subcontractors. The companies that you just mentioned. Right, they are not the major ad agents.
So they're not even getting a seat at the table. They're just saying, okay, we'll give this to you guys and move on.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yeah.
And again,
so nothing has changed.
Look at the backdrop, and I think this is a very timely discussion. The demographics of our society is changing. The browning of America, quote unquote. Remember, I guess it was 10, 15 years ago, Time magazine put on the front page, the browning of America. It scared a lot of people. But the truth of the matter is, the browning of America has accelerated. And even though we have more racial and ethnic people, we are much more a multilingual, multiracial, multicultural society. The gross national product of our nation did not go down. It continued to increase. So this whole fear of the browning of America, at least from a pure business and economic reality, was unfounded. I think that what a lot of businesses like Amazon or Google, they will tell you that diversity has helped them increase their profitability, that diversity is good for business. But unfortunately, I would say that the automotive industry, and I know that's the focus of our program today, has been a little slow in affirming that it is good for the automotive business to do direct business with people of color communities.
Is there any indication that
this, go ahead, Frank.
Is there any indication that this is changing? Are you making any headway? Are you in, how should you say, in the same position the NNCP was in 20 years ago?
Another very good question, and y'all asked some great questions right on point. The truth is we are making progress, and I'm pleased to report that to you. Is the situation changing? Yes. But I would say, is the situation changing fast enough? That answer is no. So while we're seeing some changes, even with some of the big automotive makers, I still would say from our vantage point that change has been exceedingly slow. At a time you would think, particularly where car sales are going, new car sales are going today, you would think there would be a corresponding increase in doing direct business with African Americans, Latinos, and Asian Americans, even Native American people of color communities, more. But I guess some people say BIPOC, you know, you come up with all these acronyms to describe our communities. So yes, Brother Washington, we are making some progress, but in my view, that progress is not at a pace that it should be. It should be much more accelerated. But right now, we are making progress, but in my view, it's at a too slow pace.
If I can, Ben, take race out of it for a second and focus on newspapers and the readership. You mentioned the average age of your membership being somewhere in 60, 65 year area. Doesn't the fact that your newspaper readership is
average age of owners, Dave, not the readers.
No, no, but I'm thinking, Roosevelt, that they coalesce.
It's a different. No, our readership is intergenerational. In fact, the largest group that reads our newspapers, you'd be surprised, it's 18 to 30.
I am surprised. Very surprised. Right.
The publishers are in the 60 realm, but the readership is different from the age of the publisher.
Is that online readership?
Online as well as circulation, subscriptions.
Okay. Well, that pleases me. I don't think that's the perception, though, of the ad buying community. The perception, I was showing advertising, and I'll say that literally, doing advertising 10, 15 years ago on behalf of community newspapers in the Dallas area, as well as alternative paper of the Dallas Observer in the Dallas area, calling on both dealers and regional marketing associations.
Right.
And those folks would rather carpet bomb advertising dollars on local TV than even talk to a newspaper ad representative.
Well, it's interesting. Dallas is an interesting place. Even today, we have 5 African-American-owned newspapers in Dallas alone.
Okay.
Brother Washington's family has the Dallas Weekly. We have the Dallas Examiner, the North Dallas Gazette, and others that are well-placed there in Dallas. The thing is, in the Metro News and several other Garland News, right there in Dallas. And all of them are staying in business. They print, they do digital, They're very much involved in social media. In order to get the vote out, if I can use this in Dallas, all the politicians, they advertise in the papers. But the automotive companies, you know, Toyota is based right there in Dallas.
Right.
But we get very little auto advertising from Toyota. Mm-hmm.
Well, and a follow-up question would be two follow-ups, actually. One, politics is local. You would think in terms of messaging, a local newspaper would be an obvious choice in doing that messaging. And I'm pleased that you're getting some of the political play from presumably African-American politicians. I can speak to what the presence is for a paper I currently write for in Dallas, Katie Trail Weekly. They don't get that political support, nor do they get automotive support. They get the real estate support, they get the restaurant support, they get virtually every aspect of consumer living except automotive, despite having an automotive column for the past 4 years. A follow-up question was going to be, of your association, how many of those member newspapers run an automotive column on a regular basis? And if they do, do they perceive a difference in responsiveness from potential ad buyers because they cover automotive topics?
Well, most of the automotive news we get is from Roosevelt through BlackPressUSA.com and distributed. We have our own internal wire service within the NNPA. So a lot of our newspapers there in Dallas, across the state of Texas, and across the United States, get the very good content about automotive facts, trends, new cars on the market. But to answer your question, do they have a consistent automotive column? Most of them do not. That's something we should look into. I do know that a lot of our newspapers do get some automotive ads from dealerships, which is different from the automotive company. Because dealerships, when they have new opportunities, they do advertise in our newspapers. But the parent, if we're talking about the like Ford Motor Company or General Motors or Toyota Inc., the big companies, while we get a little some advertising, it's not proportionate. I think it's not in proportion to our car sales. Mm-hmm. Now, one thing is research, data. There are some people who sell, a lot of my salesmen say, Rev. James, go get, pay for this research so we can show the automotive companies how many cars that we are buying. And we tried that, very expensive research. But even after we presented the research, that still did not, that was not enough in our situation. Uses the case example to turn the tide. So I still think if I had to put my finger on where we need more cooperation, more collaboration, is that the ad buys that are determined by the major advertising agencies that represent the automotive company. Mm-hmm.
Well, I know I've seen, and like I said earlier, Frank Watt writes a column that's carried by quite a few of the black newspapers. And Dave, to answer your question, when I travel across the country to the different cities and I do find a black newspaper, I try to find one in that community and I look at it.
Right.
And if I even see Frank's article, to answer your question, most of the minority newspapers, African-American newspapers, do not get local dealer ads on a regular basis.
Right.
They may get it during February, Black History Month, but rarely do they get, like, say, a six-month or one-year ad buy.
That's correct.
And even in communities like Washington, D.C., where you have some of the best African-American newspapers that have been around forever, like the Afro and the Washington Informer, they don't get local dealer ads with a high African-American population in and around Washington, D.C., where the income is higher than probably most of the United States. Mm-hmm. You go to a place like Atlanta, Georgia, like Dr. Chavis said.
Yes.
They have, I think, three or four African-American newspapers, and they don't get local deal ads. But from a national standpoint, Dr. Chavis, I guess another question to you is, what do you think it's going to take for these car companies to see you for the value that you offer?
I think they learn by example. I think that the NNPA right now, we're engaging in a long-term advertising agreement with General Motors, where, for example, 2023, 2024 to 2025, already know what their commitment is going to be, and they already know what our capacity to meet their commitment. So, what I'm going to show as a result of this commitment, that car sales go up in those communities where General Motors consistently have advertised, and not just during a particular spring campaign or fall camp, but throughout the calendar year. I think we have to show, we need case studies like that to show the return on the investment. Because at the end of the day, this is not about charity. This is not about goodwill. This is about good business. And what we're trying to do in the NNPA is to exhibit the good business formula for doing business with our member publishers, which also covers not just the print, but the digital and the social media. So when we sell advertising now, we don't sell just one format of distribution. We try to do a package deal that includes the print, the online, the digital, and the social media.
Now, I remember when that car companies used to say, well, they don't have websites. That's by the wayside. They always seem to want to put up a hurdle that you have to jump in order for them to sit down with you and get serious about spending ad dollars.
That's true. Well, one of the things I think is interesting, and I know you're supposed to be asking me the questions, but listen, there's an intersection now going on between technology and automobiles, which I think is very interesting. Technology is going to drive the electric vehicles. Technology is going to drive what are the new gadgets, what are the new performance measures by getting an EV. And interestingly, a poll just came out to show that African Americans and other communities of color are more inclined to get in an EV than other communities. So, wow, if that's true, you would think, again, that the major automobile companies are moving toward EVs would rush to advertise more in our communities. But again, there's an internal disconnect between the people who, like Mary Barr, who's the CEO of General Motors. She's on the public record saying she wants General Motors to be the most diverse, most equitable company in the automotive field. That's a great goal. But reaching that goal has been a struggle for GM. I'm talking about internal hiring, internal policy making. And we have a 50-year relationship I'm very pleased about between the NNPA and General Motors. So I'm not picking on General Motors. I'm using it as an example that sometimes even after the company commits from its CEO that it's going to go a certain direction, it takes time to unwind or to develop new relationships with communities at a time that the technology is changing not only what is produced, but how it's produced.
Dr. Chavis, a few minutes ago, you mentioned about the fact that NNPA is also servicing a lot of the digital platforms and social media. As you say, the technology evolves. How important will these new platforms, these new outlets, whether they're digital, social media based, or short forms like TikTok, how important is that in reaching not just the African American community, but other communities that tend to be underrepresented and overlooked by mainstream advertisers?
Again, you're right on point. I think that the internet, while there's some difficulties with the digital divide, the internet divide, the truth of the matter is technology can also help level the playing field. The thing that I lament right now about social media platforms, TikTok, Twitter, Snapchat, Facebook, Instagram, et cetera, and even LinkedIn, we don't own any of those platforms. So one of the things that I'm doing now with the NNPA, next year will be my 10th year, and one of the legacy things I'm trying to leave before I retire from the NNPA, we over the last year, we've been developing our own NNPA app. But in the developing our own app, I discovered that by the time most people invest thousands of dollars in developing an app, by the time the app is developed, it's already obsolete. That's how technology changes so fast. But what I want to share with you before I leave the program is that we now have an interest in developing, not an interest, we are committed to developing a social media platform that is owned by African-Americans and other people of color. We haven't named it yet. In fact, this is probably the first public announcement about it. So, Brother Roosevelt, you get the clues for this.
I told you in the green room, we weren't looking for scoops, but go ahead.
I know. I got you, but it's out there. What I'm saying is that in 2023, the NNPA will be unveiling an app, not just a domestic app, but a global app for Black news all over the world. And we will hopefully, God willing, also be lifting the curtain on the development of the first social platform that will be owned by people of color.
Just an aside, what do you drive?
I have an electric vehicle. My son has a Tesla, which is electric. And I ride a bicycle to work. I'm in Washington, D.C. So I don't have to find a place to park a car. So I pedal, I walk. And then when I need a vehicle, I'm in my son's Tesla.
Now, you know, they have electric bikes now.
Well, yes. But, you know, it's better for the heart that you pedal a little bit.
Right.
I was going to say, if you, smart man would keep himself healthy. My only final question to you is, look in your crystal ball. 3 years from now, what do you see will be the position of minority-owned media and relation to the auto industry, and what you see will be the big trend among automotive drivers and commuters of color in terms of what their personal transportation will be?
I see an acceleration of the next 5 to 10 years of what Brother Washington asked me earlier. I see the trend toward diversification, the trend toward inclusion, the trend toward not only having a goal for greater equity in the automotive industry at all levels, including advertising, including sales. But I also see that on the design side, a number of the new cars are actually being designed by engineers that are graduates of HBCUs, historically Black College University. So I am optimistic, to answer your question, that our place in the automotive industry will continue to increase, but not just as consumers, but also as producers, designers, and distributors.
Any final
Thank
questions?
Thank you so much.
Dave, Frank?
Yeah, I've got one.
Go ahead.
The question is, and I know you know this, is that it's the darndest thing that people are opposed to the inclusion of Black people simply because they're Black. I think it's called racism, you know? And as long as you can make it without including people, you know, not only Black people, but other people of color, it's like, hey, fine, we can do that. Because, you know, I hate to say it, But this country is so steeped in racism, it's shameful. But that said, as the market, and we used to say this 10 years ago, but as the market fractures and everybody, when I say everybody, I'm talking about all automakers, are scrambling for customers. A lot of these barriers that are based on racism are going to fall. Would you agree with that?
Yes, I would agree with that. And Frank, what I'm also indicating that the deep rootedness of systemic racism in America, the roots have not been uprooted, but the ground that is surrounding these roots has been disturbed enough. See, I'm from North Carolina. I used to be a farmer. Before you can pull a root out of the ground, you got to disturb the ground that holds the root. And I believe that the ground that has held racism, the roots of racism so long, that ground is not as solid as it once was. It's not as impenetrable as it once was. And for that, it gives me optimism.
Great, thanks.
Thank you.
Dr. Chavis, I want to again thank you for taking the time to be on the show. I've always looked forward to speaking with you. Hopefully we can have you back to see what happens in maybe mid-2023, what's going
Absolutely.
On with NNPA and advertising.
When I come back, I'll be able to show you our app and talk about our own social media platform.
Great. And thanks for that scoop that we didn't ask for. I specifically said in the green room, we don't want any scoops. Maybe I should use that tactic on other people.
Absolutely.
But anyway, I want to thank you all for watching AutoNetwork Reports Live. I want to thank you for watching the rebroadcast. We also podcast this show as well. And as always, please buckle up, don't drink and drive. Buckle up, don't text and drive. And as Frank says, buckle up, don't stream and drive. See you next time. Thanks again, Dr. Chavis. Good seeing you.
Thank you.